Hi, my name is Brandon Dixon, VP of Product for RiskIQ, and this is Attack Surface 101, Understanding Your Digital Presence and Managing Your Risk. In this first module of Attack Surface 101, we're going to be doing an overview of an attack surface in general. This is what we're going to describe during this section. What is an attack surface? Why is it important to your organization? What threats are associated with your attack surface? How can an organization reduce their risk? And what challenges do security teams face? So to begin, what is an attack surface? Well, according to Wikipedia, we have this long-form example, but really what we view an attack surface is really any of the different points or attack vectors in which an unauthorized user could essentially enter data to or extract data from an environment, your environment in this case. And so what is it about attack surfaces that are interesting? Well, it's mainly the fact that you have a digital presence by doing business online, and because of that, there's risk that inherently comes with it. That's really what we're describing with the attack surface. And so essentially, what has been said for a long time is that businesses have been going through this digital transformation. At RiskIQ, we really see that this has already taken place and that the digital transformation is really just an evolution. And in the early days, what we found was businesses were essentially taking some of their processes and moving that to online through infrastructure assets and websites. But over the years, we've seen an increase in complexity associated with attack surfaces because all of these new digital channels. So now we're not just dealing with websites and infrastructure anymore. We're dealing with mobile applications, social media, cloud-based, controls and Internet of Things. And so the attack surface that we're used to dealing with, which was already pretty difficult, has essentially evolved at an alarming rate, and it's really increased the complexity that makes it difficult to manage. And so why keep track of your attack surface? Well, simply put, understanding your attack surface means that you can better defend your organization. But if we really want to break this open a bit, let's think about it. On the left-hand side, we have a graph here that's essentially representing what someone's attack surface could look like. We built this graph out using the data that we had available just from one domain name and all of the content that RiskIQ's collected. And what you can see here is that obviously there's no labels on the individual data points, but each one of those data points is a server or piece of infrastructure that's part of the organization's digital presence. And you can quickly begin to just kind of count that we're looking at a couple hundred, if not a few thousand, assets here. And so if each one of those assets kind of make up your attack surface, well, what's the risk? Well, the risk is that one of those assets get compromised, and then that brings down the entire business. And so keeping track of your attack surface is important because not only has the attack surfaces become more complex, we have way more channels to actually monitor, but we're seeing an increase in attacks overall. And so we're not going to see a case where, we're going to continue to see that businesses' websites are increasing and their web applications are increasing. You know, now that everyone has some sort of mobile phone, at least in North America and in large parts of Europe, we see the rise of mobile applications where those become a channel that attackers could abuse and that essentially needs to be managed by the business. We're seeing more social media use overall, not only in web pages to help conduct business, but also just sharing information out, through marketing and events, et cetera. And so it's really important to understand and keep track of your attack surface just simply because we don't believe that it's stopped evolving, that it's become more complex, but it will continue to become more complex over time. And by understanding your attack surface, you're able to then understand your risk posture and then take security actions to go and reduce that risk over a period of time. So to underscore a bit about what I was saying here about attacks growing exponentially or attacks kind of going and increasing as well, if we look at this chart here, this is just a couple of noteworthy examples of attacks that have taken place. Back in 2004, when organized crime sort of entered the picture, we had our first major bank attack and commercial phishing was born. You know, over the years, we saw continued attacks maybe going against web infrastructure and web applications, going after particular server technologies that were running. And then we started to see more rise in mobile applications and our first mobile malware. And then we had a couple of mega breaches that occurred where over 1 billion records were essentially stolen. We started to see an increase in prominence with social media, and that began to get leveraged by attackers. And then, you know, just in the past year alone, we're seeing nation states and crimeware activity that is just impacting people on a global scale. We're not seeing just networks being taken down, but we're seeing entire businesses essentially going offline in some cases or being held for ransom. And so what you can see here is that naturally attacks have risen. You know, this doesn't necessarily represent the totality of all the different attacks, but with the, as each year has progressed and we've introduced a new digital channel, the criminals have been taking note of that and essentially latching on and exploiting that for their gain. And so over time, as the attack surface continues to become more complex, as we get more digital channels, we're going to see more attacks take place. And it's important that we're paying attention to what our attack surface looks like so that we're not being one of the people that are reported here on one of these attacks. And so another way of thinking about this is, you know, there's a number of different threats that can impact your attack surface. So what we previously just looked at was noteworthy attacks, but let's think about this in a more holistic way. We have our digital channels up top, web, mobile, and social. And for all intents and purposes, web in this case is going to be comprised of Internet of Things, infrastructure, cloud, web apps, etc. And on the left-hand side, we have your digital presence. These are all of your assets that exist online. And we've essentially broken up the type of threats that could take place against your digital presence into three different categories: known, unknown, and rogue. So known are all assets that are accounted for and owned by the organization through personnel or technical controls. So let's say that you understand, maybe you've been tracking all of your web applications in the business, and you know the threat that you might be faced with there is, even though you know about all of those assets, there's still the risk that they could get compromised and then defaced. But those are known assets. So you have some visibility into them. You can actually be putting mitigating controls in place and making sure that you're doing your best and that the security function is really protecting everything you know here. The next layer is a layer that we find that's pretty common among most of our customers, and this is the unknown. So these are assets that are not known or unaccounted for by the organization, but do have a direct association. A good example of that might be cases where there's shadow IT or orphaned IT or unauthorized partners that have some connection to your business. It's not that they're malicious in any way. It's that the security team or the security group doesn't necessarily know about these assets and thus cannot put in the appropriate mitigating controls or patches and account for them inside of their risk posture. Last but not least, we have our rogue assets. And so these are ones that are created by nefarious or malicious entities that are looking to harm the business, their customers, or their employees. And so these might be things like cases where an attacker sets up a fake social media profile that's infringing on your brand and trying to defraud your customers in some form, or maybe they're conducting a phishing attack. These are assets where the organization itself doesn't have any direct connection to this malicious activity other than it using their brand or reputation or going after their customers in some form. And so we still consider that part of your digital presence simply because it is part of your attack surface and that it does impact the business in some form. And so to underscore this, I have a chart here of the biggest data breaches of the 21st century. And on the left-hand side, we have this table, which is comprised of a number of very prominent companies, most of them recognizable to anyone here that would be viewing a presentation like this. And then the number of accounts that were essentially leaked out or compromised when the company was breached. On the right-hand side, we have the way in which the company itself was breached. In some cases, it's a two-stage attack. In other cases, it's just more of a direct attack. And so what I think is important to note here is that all of these companies are fairly large, and it's quite possible that they dedicated a pretty sizable chunk of their budget to handling security-based issues. And even if it wasn't a sizable chunk of their budget, they at least were taking security somewhat seriously. And I think what's important to note here on the right is that all the vulnerabilities or the attacks in this particular case appear to be coming from the external side of the house. In other words, there's an asset that was on the internet, part of the business's attack surface, that wasn't appropriately accounted for, which ultimately led to the breach of the business. And so, for example, we have eBay that had suffered from a spear phishing attack that then had a vulnerability exploited, 145 million accounts essentially released. We had Target, where a spear phishing attack came in through one of their trusted vendors. Their vendor got essentially compromised, and that led into the Target network, which then led to a breach of 110 million accounts. And then finally, RSA Security, 40 million accounts, spear phishing attack came in, vulnerability exploited, same picture. And so what's important to note here is all of these attacks are not sophisticated really in any means. I mean, they could be, but we're talking about an externally facing attack, which more than likely involved just one or two assets. And so going back into that graph that I showed earlier, your attack surface could be comprised of hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands, maybe even hundreds of thousands of assets. Any one of them could be the asset that essentially gets compromised and causes a breach if your network is not set up for resiliency. And so attack surface understanding is extremely important. Now, how as an organization could I go about reducing my risk by managing my attack surface? Well, one, you could have an accurate up-to-date inventory of assets that's owned by the business. You know, this is hard by itself. You know, we're talking about going across web, mobile, and social assets, and even those on third parties, and making sure that you have an up-to-date inventory there, and understanding who owns those assets. You find that this can be pretty difficult to do. The next stage here is something that we've been doing for about a decade now, you know, if not longer, patching vulnerabilities, using mitigating controls, putting firewalls in place. These are all the common practices that we're used to hearing and seeing inside of a business. One of the third point here that I like to point out is a reduction of orphaned assets and those lacking clear ownership. And so we think about businesses and how they've evolved over time and with their internet presence. And a lot of businesses have probably not gotten a good handle on all of the assets that they have. They're trying to grow quickly. Maybe they're expanding or they're purchasing other businesses. And they have a lot of assets that may just be old, outdated items that they either forgotten about or don't have a clear owner. Those assets are important to understand because they probably pose the biggest risk to the organization. If the organization is not tracking them, or they're not being patched appropriately, or they don't have the mitigating controls, then they're the ones that are probably most likely to be at risk of being compromised. And then they're the ones that could potentially be the case for why you ultimately had a breach inside of your organization. The fourth point here of monitoring all digital channels for potential impact to an organization is fairly new, and this could be very wide in terms of the amount of effort that it takes, but it is important to call out. Understanding, you know, attackers and what they might be doing with, you know, your business across web, mobile, social, and even dark web locations is particularly important. So looking for your brand name, specific keywords, mentions of your partners, etc., can be very helpful in understanding cases where an attacker might be setting up malicious infrastructure or might be getting ready to conduct an attack before they actually go and do it. Last but not least, typically it's associated with vulnerability management as well, is applying security controls to assets and really limiting your partner exposure. So this kind of comes down to security 101, principle of least privilege, making sure that you're, you know, designing a network that's resilient if compromised, all of these simple practices that have often been overlooked in favor of trying to purchase a product that does all of these things. So naturally, in a perfect world, an organization would be doing all of those items and they would be executing them perfectly and there would just be no risk. And that, unfortunately, is simply not the case. We often find that businesses are not necessarily doing even most of the items that we mentioned. And the ones that they are doing, they're not doing them as broadly as they could or as detailed as they could. And rightfully so, there's a lot of challenges that the security team faces. And, you know, one of the things I'd like to point out here is that the problem that they're going after with the increased complexity of these attack surfaces is simply not sustainable by a human team. You need to have machines helping augment your staff and monitor this infrastructure for you and get an understanding of your attack surface. And so some of the challenges faced by security teams is just the nature of an attack surface in general. It's dynamic. So it's difficult to maintain a valid inventory of assets, ownership, and function, even if they're all physical assets. I mean, think about businesses that are giving new employees laptops and trying to manage that as employees move around the business, as they go in and they change or they upgrade hardware. We found that that is a difficult process to manage by itself, let alone having hundreds of thousands of assets that are out on the internet with no clear owner. And then on the flip side of that, understanding assets that the business may not directly control, but are posing as threats directly to the business because it's either using their name or trying to go after their customers. So that by itself, that first point is so difficult to get right. It's really just impossible for a security team to do that with some of the technology that exists today without a large portion of automation. There's no way that any one individual can be assigned that function and be successful at that. It's an ongoing scale. And that feeds into the second point. Security posture measurements are inaccurate. And so if a business is evaluating their security posture by looking at their attack surface, if their attack surface is inaccurate, then their security posture is inaccurate. And so that lack of visibility is going to mean that they might miss risk. And that could be the risk that is the biggest one to the organization. Let's imagine that an organization maybe has 75% of their attack surface discovered. They've known it. So they have a 75% is known to the business. And then maybe the other 25% is that unknown, that shadow IT that's technically associated to the business, but it's not known. If we're measuring the security posture on that 75%, we might be missing arguably the biggest and riskiest items to our business, that 25% that's not being patched, that's not having a mitigating control put in front of it, that doesn't have clear business ownership. You know, those are the assets that we really want to be factoring into our risk design so that we can make sure that we see a complete picture. And then last but not least, existing processes simply aren't going to go away because attack surfaces have become more complex. Assets are still going to need to be scanned. Vulnerabilities are still going to need to be patched. Businesses are going to still continue growing. They're going to hire new people. They're going to expand into new markets. They might purchase new companies. They might release new products. You know, the challenges faced by the security teams are that humans simply can't keep up anymore. And even when they try to do their best, they need technology to really help augment that process.